All right, everybody, welcome back. The next topic we're going to discuss is the regulation of breathing. So we're going to look at the nervous control of breathing. So we're going to look and we see that in the brain, we have two respiratory control centers. One is going to be in the medulla and the other is going to be in the pons. We're going to look at where they are located. This is the medulla over here, and there's going to be a respiratory control center. We're going to look at it in a minute. This is the pons, and we're going to have another respiratory control center. They're going to do things slightly differently, as we are going to see. We're going to start with the medullary control center. Now, what does it do? This is the area that sets the basic rhythm. So we call it actually the rhythmicity center. Why do we call it that? Because it will send regular rhythmic impulses to the breathing muscles to set the rate of breathing. This is, of course, the resting respiration. There are two groups in the medulla. One is located dorsal, we call it the dorsal respiratory group. The other is located ventrally, and we call it the ventral respiratory group. So this is where we are looking. This is the dorsal respiratory group, and this is the ventral respiratory group. Let's look at each one individually. The dorsal respiratory group mainly has inspiratory neurons, which means its main function is to send neural stimuli via the nerves to the inspiratory muscles, stimulating them at regular intervals to contract for inspiration to occur. So it's going to send impulses to the external intercostal muscles and the diaphragm at a regular rhythm so that we are breathing at a rate of 12 to 15 breaths per minute. Once this stops and shuts off, this stimulation stops, expiration will occur as a passive process. How about the ventral group? The ventral group helps the dorsal a little in the inspiration, but it also contains expiratory neurons, which means they will have a role in forced expiration. So they will send stimulation to a different group of muscles, and those muscles are the internal intercostal that will allow us to do forced expiration. Now, we're thinking breathing in and out, resting, we understand this. When do we do forced expiration? An example, if you go to the doctor and he is examining your chest and putting a stethoscope and says, breathe in and breathe out. So you will force air in and force air out. This is called forced expiration. And this is where the ventral group is going to act. So we're looking at both the ventral and the dorsal over here. We can see that the dorsal is going to send stimulation to the external intercostals and the diaphragm for the rhythmic inspiration. The ventral is only responsible for the internal intercostals, which is involved in forced expiration. So this is the center in the medulla. How about the one in the pons? What does it actually do? It moderates the rhythm, which means if there are certain situations where the rhythm has to increase a little or the rhythm will decrease a little, the pons is responsible for doing that. And the pons also does something. It does the flawless, easy transition between inspiration and expiration. So we're not like I'm breathing in, stopping, breathing out. It gives this smooth transition between the phases of breathing. So in the pons, again, we're going to find two centers. We're going to look at them briefly, the apneustic center and the pneumotaxic center. What does the apneustic center do? It helps in the process of inspiration, helps stimulate the medulla to keep on stimulating the inspiratory muscles. The pneumotaxic, however, does something completely different. It will inhibit inspiration, not shut it off, but limit how much inspiration should go forth. So as soon as we expand the lung and inspiration has reached its norm, the pneumotaxic is going to stop the process of inspiration and allow for the passive expiration to occur. So it actually limits the inspiratory volume and the inspiratory rate. So we're looking at these two centers. This is the apneustic center, and this is the pneumotaxic. The apneustic will stimulate the medullary center to continue the rhythmic inspiration. The pneumotaxic will limit inspiration so we don't overexpand the lungs. All right, so we know who controls the rate of normal resting breathing, air going in and outside the lung. Are there factors that can change this normal rate? Yes, there are certain factors, and we're going to look at them together. We're going to look at chemoreceptors, whether peripheral or central, and then we're going to look at how the higher centers affect the rate of breathing. Just a reminder, what are chemoreceptors? Chemoreceptors are receptors that will notice any chemical changes in the blood. So whether there's change in the level of oxygen, carbon dioxide, or pH, chemoreceptors are there to sense this change and to react accordingly. So we're going to start with the chemoreceptors. We're going to look at the peripheral chemoreceptors. Where are the peripheral chemoreceptors located? They are located in the bigger arteries. So in the aorta, we call them the aortic bodies. In the carotid, we call them the carotid bodies. So they are sensing the chemical constituents of the blood leaving the heart. What are they sensitive to? They are going to be sensitive to any changes in partial pressure of oxygen, carbon dioxide, or change in pH, particularly if there is decrease in the partial pressure of oxygen, increase in the partial pressure of carbon dioxide, decrease in pH, which means increased hydrogen concentration or acidosis. Let's remember, all of these changes always happen together. If I have low oxygen, I have high carbon dioxide, I have acidosis. Anytime these changes will occur, my peripheral chemoreceptors will send extra stimulation to the respiratory center to increase the respiratory rate. Increase the respiratory rate. What will this do? This will restore the normal homeostatic level. So if I increase the respiratory rate, I am increasing the oxygen input, I am washing out the excess carbon dioxide, and accordingly we are reversing the acidosis. So when we increase the respiratory rate, we're restoring things back to the norm. These are the peripheral chemoreceptors. The central chemoreceptors, we call them central because they are in the central nervous system. So where are they located? Actually in the medulla oblongata. So there is a respiratory center in the medulla, and I also have central chemoreceptors there. What can they detect? What are they sensitive to? high levels of carbon dioxide. So they are sensitive to high levels of PCO2, which will result in acidosis. Why only that? Because carbon dioxide can cross the blood-brain barrier. Let's look at that. So this is the blood, this is the brain, this is the medulla oblongata, and the only gas that can cross the blood-brain barrier is carbon dioxide. So if I have increased level, if I have high levels of PCO2, CO2 will diffuse and will enter into the cerebrospinal fluid, and the carbon dioxide will mix with water, forming carbonic acid, and this will break into bicarbonate and hydrogen ion, which means acidosis. If this occurs, who will detect this change? The chemoreceptors. And accordingly, what will the chemoreceptors do? They will stimulate the respiratory center, increase the respiratory rate to restore back the norm. This is another nice depiction of the central chemoreceptors of the cerebral capillaries and how when PCO2 rises, CO2 diffuses, we end up with acidosis. The central chemoreceptors will detect this abnormal change. This will stimulate the respiratory control center in the medulla. It's right there in the medulla, and ventilation will increase, and this will restore the normal CO2 and pH. All right, so we spoke about the peripheral chemoreceptors, the central chemoreceptors. What else can affect the respiratory rate? All right, these are two together combined. The peripheral are in the blood. It's going to detect changes in O2, CO2, pH, and will affect the respiratory center to increase the ventilation. This is the central chemoreceptors. Once PCO2 rises, it will diffuse to the cerebrospinal fluid. Central chemoreceptors will detect it, and this will increase the ventilation. So this is the combined view of both of them. Now, how about the higher centers? Do the higher centers have any role in the control of breathing? Yes. So we're going to talk about a few of these. First, we're going to look at the cerebral cortex. Cerebral cortex is right here, and we call it the higher center. It has a role in voluntary breathing. So it has the ability of increasing or decreasing the rate of breathing voluntarily. When does this happen? I'm going to give you an example. So if somebody has a certain lung disease and the doctor says you need to do some breathing exercises, you need to breathe so many minutes in and out in a certain routine, this is going to occur voluntarily. So a person is going to say, okay, it's time for my breathing exercise. I'm going to start to breathe in and out at a certain rate. This is voluntary. Who does this? Who controls this? It is definitely the cerebral cortex. What other higher center? The limbic system. If you remember, the limbic system, it is what we call the emotional brain. So sometimes when we are scared or excited, we breathe faster, so this will stimulate the respiratory center to work at a higher rate. The hypothalamus also is where we have the regulating center for temperature, and during fever, breathing can increase, and again, it has a good physiological role. So this concludes our talk on the control of breathing. We've seen how it occurs from the higher centers of the brain, and we covered different factors that can affect the rate of breathing. And thank you.